to do about this?
It is an issue that's on our agenda.
We don't have to resolve it tonight.
I'm not sure that there is any resolution.
Do we need to resolve that?
I don't have to. I think as long as at some point it's made clear in the record that when you're approving the preliminary and the final plans, that you're also approving amendment to an already approved subdivision. I mean, as long as that's clear, then I think you're covering all the bases.
Okay.
So that as long as you understand that and it's worked in tandem, you're okay. But I think this also allows you to bring in any improvements that you might want to see happen to that section of Huntsman Road Extension. It gives you an added ability to bring that in. If there's something that you think needs to be done there to reduce any adverse impacts of the subdivision.
Okay. Anything else? Well, we thank you very much. Did you have anything else, Mr. Frinsco?
I want to make sure that the reference to the amendment is on the plan that you have.
Okay. Anything else, Mr. Decker? Well, we thank you very much for coming. I thank the public for coming, and this hearing will be extended to our next meeting on March 20th. So I'm sure we'll see all of you back again and bring all of your friends and neighbors. Thank you so much. Would the planning board care to take a break? The planning board will take a short recess. Thank you. Okay, next on the agenda, Mr. Joseph Higgins, who is seeking a public access waiver for one lot. Is Mr. Higgins here? Hi, welcome back, Mr. Higgins.
Thank you.
Did you have anything that you wanted to say, or?
Well, I brought in the deeds as you requested.
Oh, good.
And I was waiting for the result of your site walk.
Yeah, okay. Any comments from the planning board on Mr. Higgins's public access? Well, it certainly looks like a nice piece of land. We did receive a letter from our attorney. It's dated February 9th, Mr. Higgins. He feels that you indeed have a right of way. The only thing he wanted was proof of right title and interest. Right, Steve, anything else?
And then, Madam Chair, just to clarify that Mr. Higgins provided three copies of a quick claim deed, which appears to be in the property in question. I think what we perhaps would want to do, if the board were inclined to granting approval, would perhaps add a condition, which is under in the suggested motion, that would just ensure that this documentation did indeed certify that Mr. Higgins was a legitimate person to deal with the planning board on this item. I don't think there's much doubt.
Right, but
might
it
take
would
just
be,
a little bit.
It would be prudent to have him just look at that. We have the letter from the town engineer stating that he feels that everything is all right and A-OK there. Any other comments from those who went on the site walk? Certainly was cold that day, wasn't it?
Yes, it was.
Dick, do you have anything?
No, Madam Chairman, I don't. I think that from what I can see, the application looks good, looks complete. I thought that the site walk was an appropriate one. It gave us a feel for the lay of the land and how the proposed lot would be developed and how it would come out on the road. When the board is ready, I'm prepared to make a motion to accept if you wish to do that, or maybe some other member of the board would rather.
Doesn't see there.
You want to be relieved?
Yes, thank you.
All right, I'll make the motion. Except it's a long one, right?
Very long.
Oh, be it ordered at the request of Joseph Higgins. Is my thing on? I guess it is, huh? For a public access waiver for one lot, tax map U-27, lots 39 and 41, located in the vicinity of 8 Wood Road, be granted according to section 19-4-2B of the zoning ordinance and the facts presented, subject to the following conditions. A, that the access road / driveway be maintained and kept clear year-round. B, that any alteration of wetlands that occur on any portion of the proposed lot be in compliance with the applicable wetlands protection ordinance provisions in place at the time of such construction. C, that all other pertinent local, state, federal approvals be obtained by the applicant prior to the start of any access road / driveway or lot construction activity. D, that this public access waiver shall apply only to one single family residence to be constructed on a proposed lot in question. E, that the requirements of section 19-4-2B and the above aforementioned conditions shall be binding upon the present and future owners of the affected lots. F, that a covenant incorporating the above mentioned conditions shall be inserted into the deeds of the lot in question. Said covenant shall be submitted by the applicant for review and approval by the town attorney and town planner, and then recorded by the applicant with the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds within 90 days of granting this public access waiver. And finally, G, that written evidence of the applicant's individual right, title, or interest to the proposed lot in question shall be submitted by the applicant for review and approval by the town attorney and town planner within 60 days of granting this public access waiver.
Good, second. Ivan. There's a second. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor, please raise your hand. Opposed? Unanimously in favor, Alice. Well, thank you, and have a Good luck with...
There was one thing on the width of the driveway I'd like to bring up. According to the ordinance, it's supposed to be 22 feet wide at the entrance, and I'd like to see if we could get a waiver on that to get to something that fits more into the neighborhood and is a little narrower.
Yes. I remember that you brought that up the day we were on the site walk.
The road itself is only 18 feet wide at that point.
Uh-huh.
And a 22-foot wide driveway is quite wide.
So...
Madam Chairman, yes. I don't think the 22 feet is inappropriate. As you may be having cars come in or go out, you'd have the space at the beginning of the driveway for the two cars to pass. I don't think it's inappropriate at all to have a 22-foot section as our public access waiver requires, in spite of the road only being 18 feet there. It doesn't go back that far. It can quickly go back to something less than 22 feet. But mm-hmm. the entrance should, I would think, keep an open-throated area.
Mm-hmm.
The other question is that public safety vehicles may have to make a turn into that driveway. They may need that much of a surfaced area to get in. It's a tough road to get in and out of, and I'd hate to restrict the driveway even further in case something like a fire truck or something had to get in there. I'd hate to make it narrower, make it more difficult for them.
Do you have the land for that, Mr. Higgins?
Oh, yes.
Oh, you do?
Well, the right-of-way itself is 50 feet wide.
Oh, good. Okay.
It's just that most private drives aren't 22 feet wide, but if it's necessary, I'll do it. There's no...
How do the rest of you feel about that, Alan?
Just a thought. A possible compromise, would it be perhaps something to consider to have just the entrance 22 feet and then taper to 18?
Well, according to the ordinance, it has to be 22 by 50 feet deep, which is quite a piece of pavement. And this is, I believe, is the same for a road entrance, is it not?
The road entrance would be, I believe, 24 feet.
Mm.
And much further than 50 feet in depth.
Since this driveway is not a long one, I certainly would be willing to waive the 22 feet after the opening and go down to a lesser width. Eliminate all that pavement and disruption. What do the rest of you do?
I agree with you. I think that the neighborhood is such that I think a 22-foot wide swath of tarmac would look horrible.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Maybe you can compromise.
Has the...
Well, we have opinions. Part gravel or... I don't know, but I could see a compromise on it somewhere.
Has the fire chief looked at this?
Fire chief has looked at it, but only in relationship to the current proposal. In fact, he waived his normal requirement of having an adequate turnaround. I think partially because of the closeness of the house to the road. I don't know mm-hmm. how much you relied on the pavement width that was shown. I mean,
right.
That's something he indeed looked at. How strongly he relied on it, I don't know.
Mm. How far back would the house be from the...
If you look on the original plan, Mr. Higgins has one, it would just go back pretty much the 50 feet goes back to the easement area and stops there, then so it widens and gets narrower at that distance right there. Okay.
I've drawn this a little larger. You can see this would be a driveway of approximately 14 feet, and then this would make it the 22 feet wide for the 50 feet back in the yellow.
Madam Chairman, I'd reiterate, in spite of what may be more appropriate for an urban concentrated area, that there are many driveways that are 22 feet wide that are essentially two cars wide. A parking stall is 9 by 18 or 10 by 20, depending on your ordinance, and having something 22 feet wide is not much more than two cars passing I would think particularly where the fire department has waived the normal requirement for a public access waiver for turnaround inside because of the closeness of the house, that we would want in this location that 22 feet for whatever purposes. And I, you know, I think of the curves as you come out of there, and remember there's a dead end street that curves mm-hmm. up around to the right, and this area is a very hilly, curvy area. That I would think it would be a tough condition to have one car waiting to get out, and perhaps mm-hmm. another one coming in with vehicles turning down. I just think it would be outside of aesthetics, it would be a wiser idea to continue to have the 22 feet. And maintain some consistency in our public access waiver ordinance.
I agree.
Anyone else? Judith?
Another idea. How about if we had the tarred part a certain width and then had gravel edges that were, I mean, really, you could drive on them and fire trucks could go on them. They just didn't look like blacktop.
I don't know. I know exactly what Judith is suggesting, and I think that it's appropriate for, and it's principally an aesthetic issue,
for me.
As much as anything. And I really don't want to argue the issue. I've stated my thoughts.
I agree with you. I'm just, the neighborhood is so quaint. It's the little tiny winding streets and houses are so close together. I'm just trying to make this fit in as well as it can without it looking terribly inappropriate. Now, if he had a gravel driveway, it made it 22 feet.
Again, Madam Chair, I'm not going
to... I know it. I'm just, you know...
I have thoughts that are very much along the lines of Judith's, and I really like the idea. I'm going to stick with 22 feet.
Do I hear anyone making a motion to change the requirements on this driveway? If not, I'm afraid that you will have to comply, but we wish you well, and welcome back to Cape Elizabeth, and drive safely back to Derry.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next on the agenda, we have Stonegate 4, a 22-lot major subdivision off Stonegate Road. Welcome back, Mr. Taylor.
Good evening. As the board recalls, at the last regular meeting of the board, we reviewed an application completeness checklist prepared by Mr. Butler with regard to the issues under consideration. The board found the application to be incomplete at that time. I prepared and submitted to the board on February 2nd, 1990, a rather lengthy letter with a number of attachments that I believe addressed all those issues. Mr. Butler has prepared revised completeness checklist, and I guess that you can either go through them item by item or only take those items that are not indicated as okay, whatever the pleasure of the board is.
Mm-hmm. I think we should just take the ones that are partial and not okay.
Okay. I'm looking now at the application completeness checklist for the preliminary plan review, mm-hmm. which is a two-page document dated February 15, 1990. The first entry is item 8B, where it is indicated partial, in that this is an issue that will come up several times. It is not, in our opinion, appropriate at the preliminary plan level to provide the detailed survey and information data that the ordinance requires. We have instead worked at a 100-foot to the inch scale and topography determined by photogrammetric methods, as opposed to a 40-foot to the inch scale and topography determined by field instrument survey methods. And it's our understanding that the town engineer does not object to this process, but has left the determination here up to the board. I would refer the board to the town engineer's February 12 letter in this regard. Are there any questions that I might answer on this item?
Any questions? Well, I have a question, Steve, unless you would rather comment, Steve, and then I'll ask you a question.
Maybe I'll just comment briefly. I think most of the items here are that I've listed as partial are relatively minor. I think the application really truly is all but complete. And the one question in terms of the asterisk items relates to what Mr. Taylor stated, and that is that he feels and has stated that that level of information, in his opinion, is best provided during the final plan when much more detailed set of plans can be developed and put forward, and then the final details will be engineered and everything will be fine. And so that's why I put the asterisk there. The one point is that in other subdivisions, the board has required some of this type of information during the preliminary plan review stage. I just wanted to raise that issue. It's up to you to decide at what point you want it submitted and what's most appropriate. I just wanted to highlight that fact.
But you're stating that other applicants have had to provide this information.
In some respects. That's mm-hmm. not to say that Mr. Taylor's subdivision doesn't have an interesting topography, I think, or a challenging topography, as the town engineer mentioned. And perhaps it's something that would be more appropriate during final. I'm not sure,
mm-hmm.
And I'm not sure I'm qualified to say what would be more appropriate. All I know is the town engineer feels on one hand that it might make sense to wait till final, but in terms of some respects of this information, some of it's information that you perhaps more normally would require during preliminary plan,
mm-hmm.
perhaps on a flatter site.
I would like to point out that in each of these categories, we have complied with the requirements of the ordinance to the extent that the quality of the topographic information and the inch equals 100 scale allows. So that it's not a question of no information, it's a question of recognizing that there are certain limitations with working with planning scale information. And we're asking that they be recognized and acknowledged, and that we all understand that when we go out there and survey this at the final plan stage, we are going to see changes in these areas, simply because the greater accuracy will cause us to change the design in minor ways.
Well, my only concern is that we be consistent. What we ask of one applicant, we should ask of all. Any other comments?
Again, Madam Chairman, the comment is that the applicant submits data, and whether that's technically correct data or not is something that's an issue for technical review, not necessarily for application completeness. And
mm-hmm.
if there's something that's needed for technical review and it's not there on the plans and we need it and an applicant doesn't provide it, then we deny the application.
Mm-hmm.
If there's data there, and that was one of the questions that I had of Steve, that I was going to wait for a while, but I'll ask it now. On the partials, is it that the data is shown but not detailed sufficiently, or is it partial mean that some of them are shown, some of them aren't, or does it mean that... what does it mean?
Okay. The partial with the asterisks, I think, mean that Bob Hunter said there's something, but it's not at a level of information that he would he'd feel comfortable with, but he'd be willing to wait to final plan.
That's a technical review.
Yeah, that's technical. On 10D, I guess the other partials are very minor. I'll just explain what they are. Might save some time. 10D, building location data. Mr. Taylor showed building envelopes versus possible building locations.
That's consistent.
And that's, so that's, I think, pretty minor and something the board's done in the past. The other item on 18 was the question of whether or not all natural features that the board's going to be needing to consider have been put in there. Wetlands have been shown, topography, some ledge, things such as major trees, 8-inch or greater at diameter breast height, things of this nature, off-site streams, things like that, perhaps haven't been shown. That's at the borderline completeness question. So again, nothing major, something you can perhaps ask for later on. Last item then, I guess, would be evidence of right title or interest. Having asked Bob about that, he stated there's a copy of it somewhere downstairs, and I'm going to take a look for it. There's a brief break. I'm sure it's there somewhere. If not,
on February the 16th, I brought in the stack of 23 copies of my rather thick letter, and on top of that stack was a letter to Steve saying, "Steve, here's a copy of the deed." I will also note that there's a copy of the deed in the DEP application, which has been in the possession of the planning office since January the 11th. And there is in the town records a transfer tax form acknowledging the transfer of this property into the hands of Stonegate Associates. And I swear and affirm that we own it.
And that's on tape.
It is now.
Yes. Oh, dear.
I will look for that in a second. I think what happened was the secretary downstairs probably took it and filed it neatly away in this month's planning board packet.
No, we remember from Dyer Pond that you indeed have right title and interest to this property.
Or at least at that time did.
Right.
That's good.
Any other comments on the completeness or incompleteness of Mr. Taylor's application? If there are no comments, do I hear a motion?
Madam Chairman.
Yes.
I would move that we order that the preliminary plan application of Stonegate Associates, Inc. for Stonegate 4, a proposed 22-lot subdivision located off Stonegate Road, is deemed to be complete in accordance with Section 16.2.4 and Appendix B of the subdivision ordinance and the facts presented. Be it further ordered that there will be a public hearing on this proposal at the Planning Board's March 20th meeting.
So that would be our second public hearing for the March 20th meeting. Okay.
Second.
Is there a second? Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, raise your hand, please. Okay, unanimous again. This has been a night to be unanimous. Okay, on to... right. There's got to be one thing. On to... let's see.
Wetlands.
The Planning Board Permit for Wetlands Alteration Application Completeness, Section 19-3-9. So, Steve, why don't you comment on, you have a partial here.
Thank you, Mr. Taylor. I think the one issue there is I just wanted to flag it, and I did below, that the applicant's requesting a waiver of sorts from the one-foot contour intervals, at least at this point. And I think the board was agreeable to that, but I just wanted to make sure that
just
was crystal clear.
Just wanted to flag it.
And so if the board agrees that one-foot contours aren't needed, then you could change that on your sheet to an okay. The other item, evidence right title and interest, the same issue, and your trust to Mr. Taylor in this issue was warranted. I did find the one copy in the official file downstairs. So
as in all issues, I'm sure.
Perhaps. Hopefully.
Thank you, Steve.
Madam Chairman, at the last meeting, we talked about the one-foot contour interval and whether it was set appropriately or not. Perhaps I could reiterate at least what I had commented on, and that was that the
one-foot contour intervals would appear to be appropriate when there is so much topography, or the variation to that requirement. If there is an area in the technical review that we find that we need one-foot contour intervals, we could then, and the applicant should understand that we would then request that to be supplied for a particular area.
Right. That is clear to you, Mr. Taylor?
It is, and I will note that in past projects, when the board has considered wetlands alteration permits and other one-step permits alongside dual-step permits such as subdivision, the board has said that, yes, you have your wetlands alteration permit at preliminary permit stage. However, it is subject to appropriate modification at the time we issue the final subdivision approval. And we would be providing this one-foot contour information at that time as a matter of course.
Okay. Any other questions or comments?
Madam Chairman, I just wondered on your covering letter, Bob, you had on page 4 mentioned that there are no stands of old growth timber which exists on the site, and that was done through the heritage program.
We spoke to the people at the Office of Comprehensive Planning that administer the Natural Heritage Program, and we also spoke to the Maine Historic Preservation Commission. And further, I've walked this parcel extensively over the number of years that we've owned it. There are there are a few spots where there are individual large oak trees. The board may remember from the Stonegate site walk some of the extremely large oaks that were in this area of Stonegate, right off the map on here. Well, we have several large oaks like that. We do not have anything analogous to the large area of old growth white pine that is to the north and east of the Stonegate parcel that was a concern during the Stonegate review.
I'm just looking also at a letter from Marguerite Getchell, who cites that there perhaps are some individual ancient trees or 100-year-old trees. Do you know of those, and what are your plans?
I met with the Getchells on Friday of last week at my office to discuss the project in some detail and to attempt to address their concerns. And their concerns were indeed the several large trees over in this area that are similar to the large oaks that we had in Stonegate. Mm-hmm.
I wonder, since we have a tree warden now, whether it would be worthwhile just to have our own tree warden take a peek at any significant trees that might be something to consider in the overall scheme.
I'm sure he knows of them now, because he was aware of trees that had been cut on Shore Road during the Dyer Pond subdivision process. So I'm sure that he knows of those trees now, but I'm delighted that we do have a tree warden, because, Dick and I went to a meeting where he spoke, and I was very impressed, and I think he will really be helpful to us.
Madam Chairman, maybe just to clarify that point, I think he's very familiar. I think his primary thrust has been, as he described, was to identify major trees, but also major trees that were in less than ideal condition along the public highways. I think he's really trying to identify high-hazard trees that perhaps should be taken down at some point. I'm not sure if he's gotten into all of Mr. Taylor's property, however.
I'm unaware of how great or small an extent he has. I would say that prior to the next site walk, we would propose to stake the center line of all the roads. And that might be very helpful data for the tree warden to have before he does his detailed inspection. It will just keep him oriented that much more simply and allow him probably to make a better assessment of the impact.
All right.
My other question refers to deer yards, and are there any deer yards that you know of in that?
There are no deer yards. There is a resident population of deer in this area, but no deer yards.
It is a travel way, not a.
That's
any
correct.
Sites that are.
That's correct. And it's been reviewed by the biologists at Normando Associates, both on the ground and using aerial photographic techniques. And it has also been reviewed by the Inland Fish and Wildlife as a part of the prior approvals of the adjacent phases of this project. So I'm quite confident that we don't have a problem with a deer wintering yard that we're impacting.
Okay.
Anything else? If not, do I hear a motion?
I'll move.
Okay.
Be it ordered that the application of Stonegate Associates, Inc. for planning board permit for wetlands alteration for Stonegate 4, a proposed 22-lot subdivision located off Stonegate Road, is deemed to be complete in accordance with Section 19-3-9 of the zoning ordinance and the facts presented.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor, raise your hand. Opposed? Unanimous again, Alice.
This new town manager requirement carries a burden for
the month. It's so slow.
Get your exercise, okay. Though, right? Raise your hand.
Try the left hand.
Next, I have this permit for construction in a resource protection district. What are we supposed to be doing with that?
That's something where there are some standards that the applicant needs to address, and has started to do that. In terms of completeness, given the detail of the information, the subdivision plan, and the operation permit submissions, that I guess it's my opinion that having met the completeness for both for the first two items, that in terms of submitting adequate information for you, that Mr. Taylor has achieved that for his resource protection construction.
So we can go on to D?
That would be my recommendation.
Mm-hmm. Any comments on that? Hearing none, we will go on to D. Amendment to a previously approved subdivision plan. Here we go again. I think we need the plan on paper. Something you submitted to us is sort of an overlap. Do we have the plan on paper?
When we say amendment to a previous subdivision plan, mm-hmm. what we are proposing is to change the size of lots 49 and 50
right.
that were a part of the original Stonegate subdivision.
Mm-hmm.
And those lots are located right here, and we are basically making them larger, and we are taking a portion of lot 49, approximately 30 feet wide, dedicating it as a corridor to get down to lot 22 of Stonegate 4. So the revised configuration of the lots is shown on the preliminary subdivision.
Right.
Plan. And the original configuration of the lots can be inferred from the strong project boundary lines that have been placed there. If that's not sufficiently clear, perhaps we can mark one up a little bit better.
Is it sufficiently clear to the rest of you? Mm-hmm.
Madam Chairman,
yeah.
Mr. Taylor also had indicated at the last meeting that those lots are still owned by Stonegate Associates,
mm-hmm.
So that there's no change to any property that has been sold or in any way conveyed, and that's still the case. I would ask whether during our public hearings of this that we would have to notify all of the residents of Stonegate by their association requirements
mm-hmm.
If there are any changes to the subdivision. And
that has already been done, has it not?
Well, when we sold lots in the vicinity
yeah.
of this corner of the project, we were very careful to inform people that we were considering some changes to these lots to accommodate future development on this parcel.
Mm-hmm.
Secondly, we have, under our original Declaration of Covenants, always reserved the right to change the use or function of any unconveyed lot, subject, of course, to the Planning Board's approval. And finally, we recently, a year and a half ago now. Half a year ago now. We recently amended the covenants to specifically mention this project and the possibility of changes in this area. We have in our list of project abutters to whom we have sent notice of the proceedings pending at the DEP, included everybody in Stonegate Subdivision. But I'm not sure that that's a legal necessity. I think that we're probably constrained in this instance by the ordinance, which is something like the 25 closest abutters. We've also held a meeting with the Stonegate Homeowners Association and explained this proposal. So I think that we've addressed the public notice issues adequately here.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the one last step or one piece of follow-through is that the public hearing notice go to the entire Stonegate abutters list.
Okay. Any other comments?
Yeah, yes. One question. The way you've now changed Lot 50, it looks like you've incorporated some resource protection area into that lot. Is that right? I'm looking at your preliminary subdivision plan, L1.
Yeah, it does.
Didn't have that before, but it does now.
Well, it did and it didn't, in the sense that Lot 50 contains wetlands that are identified on the subdivision plan of Stonegate, and wetlands that are contiguous to resource protection zoned areas are indeed included in the resource protection zone.
But if I go by your bold boundary that you just said was the old boundary of Lot 50, there wasn't any. Before.
We have not shown wetlands on Lot 50.
Before.
They do exist.
Well, they do exist.
And they are shown on the Stonegate plan.
Okay.
So
this is incorporating more wetlands. It's not incorporating new wetlands.
Okay. Yeah.
Madam Chairman, just a quick question. What is the total amount of wetlands that you will be altering? And I just thought of that when I asked that question.
19,000.
Well, that was the
200
the 19,000 square foot number that you may have seen in the notice to the Department of Environmental Protection assumed the construction of additional roadway down through here.
I see.
And we have, as you will note, reconfigured the proposal. And on page 5 of our February 2 letter, we discuss that along the edge of the proposed double-barreled access road in this vicinity, we will be affecting 5,500 square feet with some 6,950 cubic yards of fill. Along stations 1430 to 15 plus 35 of Greystone Road, which is our crossing of the wetland finger in this area, we will be affecting approximately 10,575 square feet and utilizing some 12,300 cubic yards of fill. We are also proposing, along the alignment of my pencil, to install a sewer service to service Lot 1, which will result in approximately 44 cubic yards of replacement fill within the wetlands area, but no change to the finished grade of the wetlands. Obviously, we're going to dig it out, install the pipe, backfill with appropriate materials, and restore the surface to as it exists today. So, we are talking now really about 16,075 square feet rather than the 19,000 square feet that are mentioned in the DEP application.
Good. Thank you. Steve, did you have a comment about Greystone Road?
Quick question. Maybe I missed it before, but it appears as though Greystone Road appears one way, that's different than the plans that were submitted to us.
Yeah. If you will refer to the first paragraph of our February 2 letter, we note that enclosures 9 and 10 describe a revision in this area of the project. Enclosures 9 and 10 are 8.5 by 11 part plans, which show that that revision. I'm trying to flip to them here. They look like that, if that's helpful. And what we've done is we've depicted that on this graphic aid for discussion purposes. Basically, we took another look at whether it was appropriate to utilize the existing roadbed of in this area to service these lots down here, or to bring in a whole new road. And we determined that by some small changes to the intersection design down here, we could reduce the total wetlands impact and not require the additional road construction. So that's the change. It was included in our February 2 letter, but we did it by submitting a part plan rather than a revised whole sheet.
Anything else? Oh, we thank you very much.
One more thing. We're going to wrap up. The ordinance states that once application completeness is done, found by the board, that the that another site walk should be set. Just wanted to raise that and see if, at this point, it was appropriate to go out on a formal official site walk, given the fact that you've already done one.
If I may comment, we have not yet laid out the center line of the road. And we could, but I have spoken with the surveyor, and if we can set the date for a site walk, not this coming Saturday, but the following Saturday or some later date, we will have that work completed in the field before such date.
Yes, Dick.
Madam Chairman, I'd like to walk the site again, either right just before the public hearing or maybe even after the public hearing, as we're debating some of the issues that are deeper into some of the issues than perhaps we are now. I think that the closer that we can get to the spring, in terms of snow cover not being there and seeing and walking through waters and through as much wet condition, that's the perfect time for a regulatory board looking at land use changes to make the site walk, so it's an appropriate time.
Right.
I would think late March or early April might be most appropriate.
I agree. And much warmer, too.
Much warmer.
And cold people.
You and Alice will be off the board, and that's what we really want.
Anything else? Don't we have to sign something and give it to Mr. Taylor?
That was done first time.
Oh, good. Okay.
Should we at this time pick a late March or early April date, or should we wait perhaps till the public hearing?
Why don't we wait for the public
hearing? We don't have to have it before the public hearing, do we?
No, I don't believe so.
Let's take a quick look. It says, a site walk by the planning board shall be scheduled once the application is determined to be complete. It doesn't say exactly when. So.
We can. I think it would be better for looking at wetlands to go in the spring. Well, we thank you, Mr. Taylor, and we'll see you the next time.
Thank you very much.
It's just a few minutes after 10. Need I take a vote to extend our 10 o'clock?
I would move we extend.
Okay.
Sir.
Discussion, hearing none, raise your hand. Okay, we extend. We thank you, Mr. Taylor, and we welcome a representative from the Portland Headlights Keepers Quarters Building within the Fort Williams Park District. And it is our town manager.
Who is also camera operator this evening.
Some multi-purpose manager.
Well, welcome, Mr. McGovern.
Thank you, Mrs. Guthrie.
The reason I'm before you tonight is that we recently discovered in the zoning ordinance, and particularly in the section that relates to the Fort Williams Park District, that any new use within the Fort Williams zone requires that we go before the planning board for review of it. As you all know, for the last couple of years, we've been discussing having some sort of museum at Portland Headlight. While we always knew this provision was there for Fort Williams, we were unaware that that Portland Headlight itself is part of the Fort Williams zone and is, in fact, covered by that section of the ordinance. We recently looked at the zoning map and discovered that, in fact, it is part of the zone, even though the description on the map, even though the description of the zone doesn't really seem to apply to Portland Headlight. But with all that said, the main reason I'm before you is to update you on the plans that are out there now for the Portland Headlight Keeper's Quarters, and also to solicit any views you have as we continue down the process. We first became aware about 2 years ago that the United States Coast Guard was going to declare the Portland Headlight property surplus to Coast Guard use, particularly as they automated the light. As you all know, last August there was a ceremony in which they ceremoniously turned over the key to the keeper's quarters to the town. From that, just about a month after that, the town council held a public hearing on various proposals that had eventually that had been looked at over the years, and finally came up with the suggestion and voted it that it be developed into a low impact, high quality historical exhibit on the first floor and a caretaker's apartment on the second floor. That was adopted by the council, and we're here before you for any comments on that. Subsequent to that, the town council has established a building committee that is now working with an architect, the firm of Van Dam and Renner, and they are going to be further looking at that plan and developing it into a more refined concept. In addition to that, I know the board had a workshop with the Fort Williams Advisory Commission about a year or so ago, and a number of issues came up. Partly as a result of that workshop, the Fort Williams Committee has hired a firm to do a updated landscape plan for Fort Williams, as well as a parking plan. And that was funded in this year's budget, and that ties in very much with the museum, because one of the concerns is that it's anticipated, even though there aren't going to be a whole lot more people there, that in fact the vehicles that are going to be there, particularly in the Portland Headlight area, are going to probably stay for double the amount of time that they're now there, which causes a doubling of the need of parking. And the firm of Terry and Architects is working with the Fort Williams Advisory Commission on that. And hopefully some of the parking issues and some of those other issues that are needed to be addressed for the museum will be addressed by that study as well. I could go on and on about Portland Headlight. Wow. I was looking at the file today, and it's about 5 inches thick at this point, and
I know.
Ceremoniously did not bring it.
Well, it's a very exciting project. Anyone with any questions for Mike or comments or recommendations?
Madam Chairman, only that this board should stand firmly in with the town as a part of the town and in back of the administration process of turning the keeper's quarters into an asset that the town can enjoy and that visitors to the town can appreciate and enjoy. The idea of the museum, I think, is particularly worthy of a lot of attention by the town, and taking some of the history of the past of Casco Bay and of Cape Elizabeth and of Fort Williams is something that can often be overlooked as a town runs towards its future and really not looking at its history and past. And I think that's an admirable goal that the town has set and is now in the process of implementing.
I agree. It was very nicely put, too.
Don't ask me to repeat it.
Any other comments?
Madam Chairman, I would move that we order that the Planning Board recommends to the Town Council to approve the town's proposal to undertake the renovation of the Keeper's Quarters at Portland Headlight for the requirements of the zoning ordinances Fort Williams Park District provisions.
Okay, is there a second? Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, raise your hand. Opposed? Unanimous? Once again, Alice. Well, we thank you very much. We're sorry we kept you waiting, but we only kept you for approximately 5 minutes.
Yeah, thank you. If I could make one other comment, and,
sure.
As long as I'm here. From the staff point of view, as opposed to some of the comments the board might have, I can't help but note that this is the last meeting of Alice Rand as a member of the Planning Board. I don't know if you had any discussion beforehand, but...
Yes, we did.
I missed it, and I didn't have the television on at home. But I would like to say you've been terrific to work with, in the years that you've been on the board and in the years previously. She was extremely helpful, as you all know, in the subdivision regulations on that subcommittee. And we had a group about over a year ago that was meeting that was a visual access working group. And Alice brought tremendous insight to that process and has been great. I also won't be at next month's meeting. And Marion, similarly, you've been great to work with. We don't always agree on every topic, but... I know people really don't have any understanding of the amount of work it takes to be a member of this board and the dedication and the time. And, I know you as well as Alice and Dan Boxer, who's not here this evening, have really given a lot of yourselves to the board and to the community. And from the staff, I'd like to thank you for all the support you've given us and all that you've done for the community.
That was nicely put.
Thank you.
It was nicely put, and we agree.
And I also would like to say that if we hadn't had such a good staff to support us, that we wouldn't have been able to have done half what we did.
I mean, this month, after the public hearing regarding the Highlands at Broad Cove, and all sorts of things came up about emergency accesses that were blocked. This month, I knew Chief Webster was doing his... budget, took the time. We received letters that he sent to associations. The chief of police did accident history for us, as well as speed, which wasn't even brought up tonight. But we really appreciate that kind of help. And I have written those people before, but we can't thank them enough, can we? Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Last on the list, I have to ask you, we are very backed up here. We have approximately 8 items that we could not take tonight, and I'd like to ask you if you care to turn our workshop meeting on March 6th into a regular Planning Board meeting. But I think I should point out that once that is done, all that is taken up at that emergency meeting, which should be a workshop meeting, becomes old business. So it's going to catch up with you at some time. But it's up to you.
Madam Chairman, I'll make the only speech that I have made about the workshop sessions. I think that they're a great idea for a Planning Board to hold workshop sessions and to concentrate on planning issues at those workshop sessions. I've cautioned the Board in the past that by having 2 meetings a month, one a workshop, one a regular meeting, that the danger is always in busy times that those workshop meetings only become another Planning Board meeting.
Right.
And that we should continuously guard against that. And I believe that. We also recognize that there are applicants out there that want to get on for consideration. I don't know what we can do other than to proceed as expeditiously as possible and to try to retain the one planning type workshop level meeting that we have per month and one regular meeting. And we'll just have to take our applicants in due course.
Agreed. Anything else?
One comment on that. I have to beg to differ with you on one point. When we went to the 2 meetings a month,
I remember correctly, and my memory is getting a little foggy, but if I remember correctly, it was to prevent the 12 o'clock midnight planning sessions that we had been experiencing. And we said that the two meetings a month would be primarily for a workshop and for a planning meeting. But I think the proviso and the big but was that if we got a very busy, backed up agenda, we could use it as a safety valve and create the situation where we would have two meetings in 1 month. I don't like the idea of two meetings in 1 month, but the list of people that want to get on is pretty long.
I agree with that.
I would opt, I'm saying it out of one saying, I would opt to have it. I'm not going to be able to be at that meeting because I'm going to be in Washington.
Oh, of course.
What can
I say? I
would say that in advance. I'm not going to be there, but I think we have to address either in March or in April at some point.
Right.
A backlog. We've got a backlog situation, and 10 o'clock is just not going to cut it.
No. The one problem, though, about March 6th, is Steve is going away on a well-deserved vacation. He is not returning until the 4th, and I think it would be very difficult. You all know the work that he puts into gathering all of the information and the completeness lists and on it goes. I don't think we would have a very well-organized meeting.
Then we shouldn't do it.
A caveat to that.
I know
Marion's
he
kind.
Doesn't want us to change, and you know, but I think he
I
shouldn't
hate,
have to.
I don't. Yeah, I hate.
You deserve a vacation where you're not thinking about coming back to a mess,
no.
Which it would be.
I think he should come back.
Come back to a mess, or
he'll stay.
I will come back. I think unless it's so enticing, it could be done. The package. I mean, the mechanism set up to get the package out and completeness checklist on the major subdivision. There might be one or two minor checklists that would have to go. I think the other side of that, I'm not going to argue too much Marion's point, but I think, you know, if the desire is to get rid of the backlog, we could put together an agenda that could be sent out. All the materials have been submitted to Town Hall, so it could get out to you, and you'd have a pretty good feel for, you know, what's there, and you could review the materials. It wouldn't, you know, the staff review, at least in my level, wouldn't be quite as extensive as it would be normally, but you have something there, and there also are two or three pre-application conferences which are just going to be there just to get the information out.
Let me ask a question, Steve. If on that day we come up with some review for completeness and come up with some completeness determinations on some of those, what would we set the hearing? What date would this hearing set for? Could the hearing be set for the April meeting, or would that be too long?
That's... on some, the one issue, I guess, would be Spurring Woods in terms of subdivision where there's a set time limit.
Yeah.
It says within 30 days. That's the one sticking point. I guess wetlands alteration, too, for Richard Davis, that if you set it, you'd have to...
The timing starts.
You'd have to... Yeah, in essence, you
don't want to see us have two meetings a month now for forever because we've
been... Because what would happen?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What might
concern.
What you might happen is you might bump some things into that 2 weeks later, which might be awkward. Either that, or we could check with the town attorney to see if there's some way that 30-day really could be, you know, translated into the next regularly scheduled meeting.
Or we could put those things that could result in hearings off until the regular meeting.
You can
risk that.
You could do that. The risk would be that some of those might not make the agenda for the regularly scheduled meeting. Just given what you have in terms of public hearings and everything else, that if you, I would say, just going down through the list, you might have a public hearing for the Jonesy Service Center zone change request. You could have one for the wetlands alteration permit for Dick Davis. You could possibly have one for Spurring Woods at Drynan. So if you took those out at the special meeting, just took Elizabeth Heights, Sawyer Fields, and Arnold Murray, the ones that I mentioned first time might not all make it on the March 20th agenda, which means then they'd be put off to the April meeting.
Then we'd have to get a hearing on going 45 days before the next hearing.
Yeah. Or see if they would at least agree to that. We could check with Tom's office just to see legally if that could be done.
I think I'm not going to be here, but I would like to see you retain that alternate meeting for a workshop period, and it seems to me that you're going to run into a much more of a jam if you set these other things in motion and you end up tackling a lot of public hearings that will put you even further behind.
I think it would be, really be a mess when I look at this agenda. So do you all agree that we'll try not to have a meeting on March 6th?
I think we should still have a workshop meeting and deal with the affordable housing issue and deal with the mobile home or is
that... Well, that we've got to set a public hearing for that tonight. But I don't think Steve would be prepared to address the affordable housing workshop. Are you prepared
to... That's the one drawback. If you have to be more discussion, we kind of left it in nebulous. Not nebulous, but a different sort of state.
I thought we were going to have a staff report that gave us our options to present to the town council that we could take with weighted priorities for what we wanted to recommend. Not necessarily ordinance language, but some pretty good creative philosophical discussions on concepts that are opposing concepts. Debate those and recommend to the council a particular philosophical stand, get their direction, and then proceed.
And given my original thinking, we were perhaps going to have a special meeting that wouldn't be ready by the time, by tomorrow, when I leave after tomorrow. And you wouldn't have something until, you know, a day or two before the workshop. That's the problem. And I apologize for that.
If at all. Well, actually, with this Normando study and all that has been going on, Steve has spent hours on just this month's meeting.
Well, Madam Chairman, I would recommend that we still have a workshop, that we set our we sit down and we establish some goals and objectives for the next year.
Mm-hmm.
That's a perfect opportunity, given the schedule and given what we have, to debate some of the issues of whether to have two meetings a month or one meeting a month. And
that's a good idea. And perhaps we could invite all of the new people. Yeah.
I was going to suggest that the new people come along and we get to meet them. And
on February 26th, there is a meeting. Would you like to be there? I will come to that orientation meeting. I think it will be here. I announced it tonight. You probably received it. And would you be willing to be the new chair at that? Or Ivan, if you come, would you be willing to be the co-chair?
Sure.
Okay. So then I will leave it up to you men to, you know, show these people the ropes, and I can just sit down.
That's Monday night, the 26th, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes, February 26th.
And March 6th, they have a workshop with the planning
board. March 6th, we'll invite them right on the spot on February 26th and ask them to come, and you guys can sort of run that. And I'll just sit there. I love this. Oh, this is wonderful. And we have to set a public hearing for the draft of the mobile home park ordinance. We have two public hearings the next time.
Is there an emergency nature to that? Are we under a time constraint?
Well, it would be nice to...
Yes, we are under a time
constraint. Pass it on, you know.
The town council enacted a temporary measure.
Yes. 90 days.
90 days.
So we better do it.
When did they enact it?
January.
So 90 days would be February, March. So we could go to April, right?
Well, no, because any new ordinances have to be passed to the council. They have to analyze through their ordinance committee provisions and then report back to the council. And then, unless it's an emergency ordinance, doesn't take effect for some 90 days or 60 days or 30 days. Something like
so we have to do it the next.
I would think we have to do it fairly quickly.
Yeah, because then we would need the time after we listen to the public if we felt we had to change it in any way.
So we have to do that the next
March 20th.
We would do that at a workshop, so I think we'd better get going on it. That'll be our third public hearing.
I would move we have a public hearing on March 20th in the mobile home issue.
And we serve strong coffee.
And the next time we will elect officers.
At the end of the meeting.
At the beginning of the meeting. And I will turn this little gavel over to
somebody.
Someone, yeah. Anything else tonight?
Mystery guest.
Maybe we should, just to make it all formal, perhaps we should have a formal vote on setting the public hearing. So if Dick made a motion, somebody could second.
Okay. Could we have a formal vote on setting the public hearing?
I moved.
Okay. Is there a second? If you agree, raise your hand. Unanimous again. Do we need a formal vote on the workshop meeting on March 6th and inviting the new people? I will bring refreshments that evening.
March 6th?
Of March 6th. Jurors be gracious.
That'd be great.
Nice, right?
Will we adjourn?
Will we adjourn? Seconded.
All in favor, raise your hand. Thank you very much, all of you. This was a... And good night. Thank you.